I've used this recipe before and I think I had cut the bread too thick.
Hi friends, it's me, Simply Sherry. I help you stop living in chaos, one organized space at a time. Today I'm going to show you how I set up for Thanksgiving. I have my brother and his family coming over, my mom, and then us. So this will be the first Thanksgiving that we don't have my dad. And also my son is not able to come for a visit because he's saving his paid time off for the Christmas holidays. So he'll be coming then. So let me show you how I set up for Thanksgiving and the menu that we have.
Okay, it's 7 a.m. I just got up. I've had 9 hours sleep, and honestly, if I didn't have to make Thanksgiving, I'd still be sleeping. So let me do that. But here's the challah bread. I got it from our local grocery. So it's already up to here. Okay, so I think I'll just go ahead and do all of it. And whatever is left over is left over. All right, so I've sliced them now. And as I've sliced them, I just have a different thought. I think I'm just going to do, I'm gonna keep these, and these will be for French toast. And I'll cut the rest of these because there's 9 of us. And so I think this much stuffing is going to be okay. Next, I'm doing the prime rib. This is 5.2 pounds. The last one I had for Friendsgiving was 7.5. And I figured out it's 325 degrees for 15 minutes per pound. So since this is 5.2 pounds, I'd say that's an hour, 15 minutes, right? And I do that for 325. And then I put it covered. Then I uncover it at 500 for 5 minutes. I turn it off and then I let it sit there. And then I bring it out. So many recipes said 500 for 15 minutes. And I was like, this thing is gonna get burned. So I pulled it out at 10 minutes. So anyway, this is the same pork rub that I'm using. Last time I used half of it for 7.5 pounds. So probably use most of it now. So I don't remember how much this was, but it's at my local butcher shop. And so anyway, I've washed my hands and I've washed the meat. This has been sitting in the fridge. Let's see, I think about less than a day. It's not a full 24 hours, maybe 18 hours. Okay. And I saw another video that said to go ahead and pat it all down. There's some that use butter, others that say don't use butter because it'll burn too quickly. And then there's some that has kind of like a paste. Well, you know, honestly, this turned out well. Last time was kind of a test. The first time I've used this rub, and it was fine. So I don't want to make any extra effort by making a paste because I have so many other things to make, like lasagna being one of them, a little bit more labor intensive. But this is pretty easy, and trust me, everyone was very grateful for that prime rib because a lot of people don't have prime rib for Thanksgiving, usually turkey. And mentioning turkey, my family requested not to have turkey. This is like the third year in a row. I think I make a pretty good turkey. Decent, you know? Anyway, so since we're not having a full turkey, I decided, let me go look if I can just make a turkey breast just for myself. Well, that thing is huge. So I found a turkey wing, and the guy at my specialty grocery store said, just cook it like you would any turkey, you know, butter under the skin, the same kind of seasoning that you usually put. So that will be my first attempt to make turkey wing, just one turkey wing. I have made turkey breast in the past when they've requested no full turkey, so that was true. That was still actually a lot, and we still didn't even finish that. So I am going to just do a turkey wing. All right, can you see that? Sorry if it's not in the frame. So then I just try to gather things that have fallen, pack it in there. But you know, this rub isn't just salt. It's Got a lot of good stuff in there. Don't want to waste it. Okay, then we have the other side. So I usually do the top, go to the, turn it around towards the back, turn it around, then I go to the side. Okay, yeah, can you see that? Ooh, that looks good. Okay, so I'm going to put a little bit more here on top for these patches. Okay. And like I said, I'm gonna put this, I'm gonna put this in the fridge, because I saw some guy do that. And then I know that it has to be brought back down to room temperature. So it's 8 a.m. right now. Dinner's at 4. I've got to put this in the oven by, let's say, an hour and a half, at least by 2:30, probably 2:15. So I'm gonna take it out 4 hours ahead to get it to room temperature. I think that's right. I kind of timed it last time. 4 hours was a little bit too short. It was still a little bit cold, so I think 4 hours for this will be fine. Well, it's all testing, you know. It's not a perfect recipe. It's not perfectly a perfect system yet for me, because I'm just learning. Okay, just gonna close this, wipe this down. Just close this, wipe this down. By the way, I'm using a Rode wireless mic now, so as I walk away from the video, like I have done this now, to wipe this, hopefully the audio is still good. Let me know. It should be. It's an expensive mic. It's actually the mic I got from my husband, so I'm testing it out if it's one that I want to get for myself. And the reason for that is that you ask, like, sharing, you know, it's hard because he films a lot. Well, it's not hard, we can make it happen, but he films a lot. I want to start filming again, you know, beginning with this Vlogmas. So it's hard to just, like, coordinate and share, because he's at work all day long and then he films there. Okay, oh, so excited for the prime rib. And by the way, that 7.5 pound prime rib, we did give some to our friends to take home. Most of them didn't want, but there's, I think, one or two that wanted. And then we had probably about this left, this much left, and we still ate it through the week. So it's something that we don't mind having leftovers. If you don't like leftover turkeys, or you're tired of turkey pot pie or turkey casserole, whatever it is, then you just get a smaller turkey or think of a different menu. All right, the next thing I'm making is this broccolini. So I got it at my specialty grocery store. They were $3.99 a bunch. Okay, and I think I got 4 bunches. Now, I usually get it at my other grocery store, but I wasn't sure if they had it, but they did, and it was longer, probably about this much longer, but $5.99 a bunch. So I was like, I think this was a better choice. I'm not sure if I'm calculating that right. So usually I use this small Anchor, the brand Anchor, glass pan. What do you call this? Baking tray. And it fits that I can put it in my toaster oven. As I try to use everything toaster oven here, usually only during the holidays or events, like big parties where I actually bake, I use the bigger oven. And the reason for that is because I live here in Phoenix. I've mentioned this before, but I just like using the toaster oven because the oven does get hot. Okay, so you can see only 2 of those fit. So I think I'm gonna go ahead and use the longer one. So I have one long and then one short. So yeah, see, that's going to fit. Okay, I mean, I can even put it like so. I'm just testing out the size. So I'm gonna go ahead and wash these, and then it's just salt, pepper, and some olive oil. All right, so I've washed all of them. This is only just half, but I wanted to show you, if you have a bigger piece like this, you could take your kitchen scissors or you can take a knife, but you could just cut it and make it smaller. Just find a place that has like what I call like a joint, you know, someplace that just cut along the line and it'll be fine, you know, because one or two pieces of this is might be just what someone wants, not like a whole big bunch. Okay. This one I can even cut even smaller. Okay, so that I think is fine. This, see how it just becomes a smaller stock? I guess that's what you call it. Or you could just use a knife. For some of you, the knife would just be easier. Okay, there you go. So that's that. Let me add the other ones in. Oh no, you know what I'll do is I'll use this, I'll toss this and then I'll toss that, then I'll put it together. Okay, so first I put the salt. Right. Then I will put pepper, and literally this is all you need, salt, pepper, olive oil. Okay, and just be careful with the olive oil. Sorry if that's a bad angle, you can't really see. So I usually have a dispenser for the olive oil. I haven't filled it up. Okay. All right. That sounds like a lot of shaking, a lot coming out, but really it's not that much. Okay. And then this one. Okay. Thanks for hanging out with me for my family Thanksgiving prep. Another thing when I'm cooking several dishes, you know, just try to keep the kitchen as clean as possible. Okay, so, because it just gets so hectic and you just want the kitchen all clear, the sink clear, and it's a lot easier to do stuff and move around. When I'm just cooking regular dinner, I do try to clean as I go. But if I can't, it's no big deal. I can always clean up afterwards. But when you're doing a few dishes, I definitely suggest, you know, in between or right after you do a dish, you wash everything. So like this, like the prime rib that I just did, I've already washed the pan. I've already wiped down the jar. Now I put it in the cabinet. And then after this, I'll be washing that baking dish. And this will go, I'll cover this and put it in the, oh no, I'm sorry, I'm just gonna cover this and leave it out. So another thing I think about, okay, so once I toss this, right, with the salt, pepper, and olive oil, I think about, okay, does this need to go in the fridge? Well, I just try to remember back in the grocery store, were these in the fridge? No, they weren't. They were out, you know, like with all the other veggies. So it's okay to leave it out. Okay, I'm gonna put that, and then this one, let me toss, and just make sure you wash your hands in between. You know, you can never wash your hands enough when you're prepping food, because I don't use food prep gloves. I just keep washing my hands, and I've never sent anyone to the emergency room for a stomach ache, so hopefully not, right? Okay, see, that's nicely covered. Now, that should be enough. Okay. And then I'm just gonna place these here. You know, kind of cover this spot because that's where the space is. And what I do is I bake this, I think at 350, maybe 375, for about 20 minutes. And then I just kind of check, and that's usually about right. But that's for my toaster oven with the smaller pan. You know, I haven't done this with the bigger pan. And you know, ideally, this would just be half and I would just do it in two batches. We'll probably cook more evenly, but this is good, you know. So like I said, I've already washed the tray that I was preparing the prime rib on. So I'm just gonna use this to cover the broccolini. Okay, so I don't have to waste foil or plastic wrap. And then this is the virgin olive oil I have. Here's my dispenser. I don't know why I said it wasn't full, but this is what I use. And I do have a little funnel for it, but I'm just gonna see if it will go in properly. Okay, I just get it to the bottom of the neck. And let me just add a little bit more and show you how this works, because I got this on Amazon. It's fabulous, and it comes with what's that called, labels. Okay, so hope you can see that it regulates. Yeah, so I don't know why I thought I didn't have it. So it regulates how much comes out, which is amazing. Okay, that's that. Okay, friends, in my last video, the Friendsgiving, I made red mashed potatoes, and I think I'm going to put a little bit of breadcrumbs on top and bake it, so that will be different. I'm not gonna film the part about the red, making the mashed potatoes. You can watch the previous video or refer back to that. I mean, it's not like an amazing recipe. It's really, my family likes it a lot, and so, and anyone I've made it for, they're like, yeah, this is pretty good. So I use red mashed potato. I use red potatoes. Let me grab them. And I don't take off the skin. Of course, I wash it, scrub it, wash it. Salt, pepper, whole milk, okay, one stick of butter, and some heavy cream. So what I realized last time was that the heavy cream really makes it like cream, like too creamy for me. So I'm gonna use more whole milk than heavy cream. Okay, so I'm gonna fill this up with water, get that boiling, and then I'll start on my next dish. I don't know if you can hear the water filling in the back, but so here's the challah bread that I've cut. It's sitting out, and so I'm just gonna toss it a little bit to move it around so that the other pieces of bread have some air exposure. Okay, there you can see I've started the water on the stove to get it to boil. Okay, the 5 pounds of red potatoes is washed. And another thing I want to mention, that after you do a recipe a few times and it's good, then you know which store to go to, which product to get. I don't have to fill up red potatoes, you know, per potato. I just know I can grab that 5 pound bag, so, and I know which store to go to. So those are things when you just kind of repeat a recipe, then you know you're good to go, and you're not so pressured and stressed with events like this, or doing potlucks, or preparing a dinner for friends coming over, because you're kind of in the groove, you're in the zone. You have your go-to recipes. Okay, let me move this over, and let's move on to the next thing, which I think is the lasagna. So I have this pot, obviously it's smaller than a humongous one, and this is the pot I usually use to make pasta, you know, one box of pasta. And I'm only gonna make one lasagna. Now, sometimes I make two lasagnas, let's say for a potluck, but I still use the same pot and I double it. I tried to use a bigger pot and it's just too overwhelming, especially with lasagna noodles or even regular noodles. It's just easier to have to repeat the same thing that you've been doing. You know, don't reinvent the wheel, just make it better. So I'm gonna fill this up with water and put it on the stove. Okay, I've put the smaller pot here for the lasagna, moved the bigger pot there, moved the other stuff to this side of the stove. All right, friends, I have this knife sharpener. I thought at this point, before I get into the lasagna, let me sharpen the knives that we'll be using. So this is an expensive Japanese knife, so I want to be careful. The brand Shun. I keep always forgetting. I think I have to bring this to Sur La Table to have them sharpen it, but for now I'm just going to do this gently. Different. Okay, let me wash it. Okay, there it is. I mean, it's not going to look any different really on video. I just wanted to show you, nice and shiny. And then I have this regular knife. Okay, this is the Oneida carving knife. Might as well just, so I'm gonna, I think we're using this, and I might as well do this while this kitchen sharpener's out. This is, I think I got it at Walmart. So I do 10 on one side, 10 on the other. I don't know if you're counting. I count everything. That was 10. I miscounted, maybe, because I put it on this one. I think that's to get the shavings. Oh, this, I think if you want to do it manually, I don't know.
I already said 4.
Oh yeah, manual slot for polishing the edge. I guess if you want to do that part, okay. Wiping the knife. This carving knife has a matching fork. Yeah, looks good. Right, this lasagna recipe, I don't know if I've ever filmed it, but it's from Chef John in Food Wishes. Been using this recipe forever. No matter who I've made it for, they love this recipe. So since my nieces are coming, I'm gonna have 2 mild Italian sausages and then 2 hot Italian sausages. I usually just do all hot. And I found that there are 2 places where the Italian sausages are good that you get it from, like the butcher. And these are from AJ's. That's the name of the specialty grocery store, is how I like to call it, versus Bash's. So if you're in the Phoenix area, you know those places. The Bash's one is fine. It's obvious cheaper there. It's only $1 each. These are $2.50 each, but you can see that they're probably a little bit bigger. The other ones are probably only this big. Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and start cutting those. I'm just gonna get a bowl. One thing I need is like a decent size bowl. I have like Goldilocks, too small, too big. I need one that's just right, so I need to look for that. And then I try to cut it at a little bit of an angle. This is not a big deal because it's going to be buried in the lasagna, but I like it angled versus like straight. Like, look at the, okay, that's angled. So if it's straight, it's like this. I know that doesn't look any different to you guys, maybe, but it's different for me. So, and you just try to make it bite size pieces, right? So if it was something you were serving like on a toothpick, you know, you just want it to be bite sized. So I'm just going to put the Italian ones in this bowl. Okay. By the way, I love my bowls, my plates. I think I said that in my grazing table video, if you want to watch that. My daughter and I put together a grazing table for 30 guests. It was fantastic. But I mentioned those bowls here. those are my everyday bowls. We eat soup, Filipino soup like sinigang. Sometimes we even eat like a donburi, you know, we make our own donburi, with the, which is basically a rice, a bowl of rice with the main entree on top. Okay, that's that. And then for the hot Italian, and I don't wash the knife in between, it's all pretty much the same stuff, except this one has spiciness. Oh, look at that. Oh, okay. I think that's, I love hot Italian sausage. I have tried Sicilian sausage, the one from my regular grocery store, and I didn't like it. Then I did try it from like an Italian place, you know, Italian store, and I still didn't like it. It in this lasagna. Now, I mean, I like the sausage. I don't mean that I didn't like it. I just like the hot Italian better. Then I did hot Italian with Sicilian. I've done mild with Sicilian. I've done all three. And I've just found that this is, if I'm gonna make a combo, it would be these two. And if it were just one, it'd be the hot Italian. And it's not like hot, hot, you know, it just has the right kick for people who don't like spicy to be like, oh, this is spicy. And the ones who like spicy, they're just like, oh, this thing is good. All right, so while we were cutting the Italian sausage, the water has boiled for the pasta. Not yet for the potatoes. So I try to get the Barilla brand, if I'm saying that right. But anyone will do. Just the last few times I've been getting these. So I just put them in one by one. And one of the things with lasagna pasta is that I've realized that I can't step away, you know? I mean, of course you're not gonna step away for like an hour or 30 minutes, but just like, even if I go to move something from the washing machine to the dryer, I just can't do that. I just have to really be here by the stove while the lasagna noodles are cooking. And that's why for me, even aside from the stuff you have to do for lasagna, for me, that's why lasagna is so fantastic, because she can't even leave the stove. But let me know, do you guys leave the stove when you're making lasagna noodles? I'll have a whole pasta making setup that I actually haven't done yet. It's been a few years since I got it. I was in Milan, and I decided to take this pasta making class. And the guy happens to be from Sicily. It was fantastic. It was in his apartment. There were like three other people there, one from Taiwan and another two people from Hong Kong. And anyway, it's really simple. That might be one of my vlogging videos in the future. So, okay, let that boil so it's all dumped. Pretty much dumped in, and I'm gonna put the timer on the stove, and it says boil uncovered for 8 minutes. All right, while that's boiling, I'm going to toss the challah bread again. Oh, this just came to my mind. The reason I don't leave the lasagna noodles, I just stand here for the 8 minutes. Just make sure that it's at a constant boil, and I gently try to move it around just to make sure that the noodles are not sticking to each other. You know, sometimes they just attach. They got tired, they're just resting, having a party in there. Yeah, so I just try to do that, and you know what, if it gets stuck, it gets stuck. Okay, I've poured out the hot water and I've run it through some colder water. Because this is the hard part where, okay, that's okay, not so hot. Where, you know, the noodles are hot, so you gotta be careful. So I just use tongs and these other tongs. I usually have baking trays here. but I'm using one of them, so I'm just using my cutting board that I use for charcuteries. I should call it a charcuterie board. So you just lay it out flat. I mean, this is the key, right? It's like once your clothes come out of the dryer, fold them or they're gonna get all wrinkled. So you gotta lay these flat. As soon as they're ready, or they're gonna be all bent and hard to work with. Okay, looks like I needed another charcuterie board. Hopefully these will finish fitting. And what I've been able to do is to make a whole lasagna and then a half lasagna with these many noodles, so we'll see what I'll do today. I've made, so this is going to be a meat lover's lasagna. So I could make one that is no meat, or you could do one that's veggie. You know, when my son was vegan for a while, that's what I would do. Okay, these are a little bit dry, so I'll just move that one over. And I have two pieces left. So I'm just gonna go ahead and put them on top. The only issue will be, you know, trying to unstick them, but I think they'll be fine. All right, the water is almost boiling for the mashed potatoes, are boiling, so I'm gonna go ahead and move that over here because it's easier to put the potatoes instead of underneath the microwave. All right, I moved it over, it's boiling, and like what I showed you in the other video, my Friendsgiving, I go ahead and put potatoes in this strainer holder. That's easier than kind of trying to throw them in one by one or pouring the whole bowl in just to reduce the splatter. All right, I put the potatoes in. They need to come back to a boil. I'll cover it. But if you want to see how I've done those, again, go back to my Friendsgiving video and I show you more in depth what I do. Mashed potatoes are done. I decided not to put breadcrumbs because the ones I have are actually stale and it's already Thanksgiving Day. I don't want to go to the store, so. These are the mashed potatoes. They taste really good. All right, I've washed both pots and the lids, cleaned up the KitchenAid, put pretty much everything away that I'm not using. And then, so now we're gonna do the cranberry sauce. This is the simplest recipe and it's so good. If you don't like the canned cranberry sauce, then this is gonna be really easy for you. So it's basically 12 ounces of fresh cranberries, and this brand, Ocean Spray, was actually a few, like about 30 cents cheaper than the grocery brand, so I got these. And so you just put the cranberries here, and I'm just gonna wash them. So while these are dripping, you know, hopefully dry as much as possible. You don't have to dry them, but I went ahead and put them in the colander over the bowl, let those sit, and I'm just gonna put 1 cup of orange juice. And we usually drink this brand, Simply Orange, with the medium pulp, so I went ahead and got it. It's okay with the pulp in it, but you can get one without. So it's 1 cup orange juice and 1 cup white sugar. Put the orange juice in, then you melt the sugar into it. Then once that's all mixed in, then you start putting in the cranberries. If you have a child, let's say in middle school, maybe even a 10-year-old, this is a recipe that they can definitely do. Since you're in the kitchen, you know, you're just gonna be there anyway while they're near the stove stirring the cranberries. My daughter started doing this recipe at around that age. So this is something she makes every Thanksgiving. Since we're not having turkey, it wasn't actually first on the menu. So I asked her to make leche flan, which is a Filipino flan. So she's making that, and then I thought, you know what, I'm just gonna go ahead and do the cranberry sauce since I'm having that turkey wing. Okay, yeah, so 1 cup orange juice. The heat is on. And then I'm going to put now 1 cup of sugar. So I bought sugar because honestly, when I was at the store, I was like, I didn't check how much sugar I have. And I actually don't even have it prepped yet. That's one of the videos I'm going to do probably for my next vlogging month. So sugar is something I actually have to buy. I know, sorry, this is not in frame. But there, that's the sugar. And you just pour it right in, just straight on in. And then I'm gonna get my spoon to just stir it. Okay, I'll try my left hand so you guys can see. Okay, so you see how that pretty much dissolves, dissolves quickly. Then I'm gonna let it heat up just a little bit before I put in the cranberries so that it's not like completely cold. Okay, while that's happening, I'm soaking the measuring cup so I can wash it. Put the sugar and orange juice there. Put that away in a little bit. And then I'm gonna wipe this area where the sugar spilled and wipe the counter. All right, guys, it's almost the end of Vlogmas. Start commenting if you haven't already. Let me know what you think about this Vlogmas. As I stated in my first video with my channel update, that this is something that I feel like we've creatively is something that I want to do, is to take out 3 or 4 months of the year where I just vlog versus doing necessarily how-to videos. So you can watch. Probably blowing up here. I'm washing the measuring cup. Yeah, you can let me know what you think. Oh, okay, you're not too hot. Okay, and this should be enough time for the cranberries. You see how, I mean, you don't have to dry them individually. Okay. Do one quick stir first. Okay, I've covered it, and I think I'm gonna let it sit, heat up for about 5 minutes, uncover, stir. So you just kinda do that until it's all incorporated, all mixed in. And you have that consistency of a great cranberry sauce. Okay, it's actually at 3.5 minutes where it's starting to pop. You're gonna hear it pop. There's a pop, pop, pop. Okay, you can bring the heat down when it starts popping. Okay, this is another 2 minutes, or I'm sorry, 1.5 minutes, so the full 5 minutes. Okay, you can see it rendering down. Okay, it's been another 3 minutes, so 8 minutes total, and you could see how it's broken down some more. We're almost there. All right, it's another minute. This is what it's looking like. Oh, yep, yep, almost there. Several more. So you can see once the cranberries are all popped and made into sauce, then you can turn it off. So we're at another 1.5 minutes, so we're at 9.5 minutes. So I've never really timed this. My daughter is the one who usually makes this. So if you have older kids, like I said, you can do this. They can make the mashed potatoes. They can prep the broccolini. It's just salt, pepper, some cutting, olive oil. And you can be the one to put in the oven. They can even help with the stuffing. If they can cut, they can cut the bread. Or unless you have stuffing mix, that's really easy. So you don't have to do Thanksgiving dinner all by yourself. It seems like I am, because I'm filming this for you, or for my Vlogmas, and for you, and for me. Okay, you can see that? I think we have 1 more minute. All right, guys, it's been 10 minutes total. I'm turning off the stove. Ooh, see, you can see it will thicken. It looks like this right now because it's still hot, but it will thicken. So what I'm going to do, there's just a few that are left open or left full as full cranberry. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to head and leave it here like this, because we will be heating this up later, and then that should pop the rest of them. Okay, so I've prepped the prime rib. The mashed potatoes are done. The broccolini is prepped.
done the cranberry sauce. We still have the lasagna to finish up and the stuffing. So I'm gonna do the lasagna next so that that can be ready to go into the oven. Then we're going to do the stuffing that will be all prepared and that has to go into the oven too. So this recipe calls for mushrooms, which I love, but the others may not like or they don't like. So I'm not gonna put the mushrooms in here, but maybe you like onions, others don't. So take out the onions. You like garlic, others don't. So my family's okay with garlic, so I'm gonna go ahead and put the garlic in. So when I say my family, it includes my brother's family that's coming over, my mom. And one thing I really don't like doing is cutting garlic. I'm gonna get one of those like miracle choppers soon, one day. All right, can you see that? Yeah. Okay, so I tried to cut that little piece off. Just put it over there. And then I chop, supposed to be diced, as much as possible. Okay. I mean, if you don't want to use fresh garlic, I guess you can use garlic powder. You know, you don't want like the whole garlic in there or a piece of the garlic. So go ahead, take that. All right, so gonna finish up the rest of these. Okay, gonna put some of the extra virgin olive oil. Hot enough. All I do to check is just go like that. I feel in the heat. There. So that's the chopped garlic. That just for a little bit. I'm gonna add more oil. There. Must have been a bubble in there. Put the hot Italian sausage. And then the mild. I love the smell of garlic. Okay, so we're gonna cook this. Just kind of all together. And then I have ground beef that is either gonna be, I got 2 pounds. The recipe calls for 1 pound, but sometimes I put 2 pounds because I'm not lovers. I'll just stick to the 1 pound then. Okay, so you see I mixed the meat just a little bit, and then I'm gonna put, I know this looks like a lot, but like a handful of parsley, and that's it. So then I gotta have to add salt, pepper. Sometimes if you really like it more garlicky, you can add garlic powder. If you want onion powder, however you do your sauce. Okay, let me put some salt and pepper. Okay, salt, pepper. Well, a little spicy, put a little cayenne or paprika. There, paprika. Okay, mix it again. Now with the seasoning and the parsley or herbs. Turn off the stove. You can see that it's cooked through. You can always cook it only where it needs about a few more minutes to cook because it'll still cook in the lasagna. Now I have my pot again and have the heat on. I'm gonna make my sauce. So this is the San Marzano style Italian tomatoes, petite dice, crushed whole. Oh, that was on for a while. However you like your sauce, whether it's chunky or, you know, chunky tomatoes in it. And then this is diced tomatoes. And I don't drain it. I guess you can drain it. And then I also like to put some
red wine. I've even tried it with white wine because I didn't have a red wine open, and my husband is the one who opens up the wine, and I've just never learned or bothered. And so I've used white wine, it's fine. But here's some red wine. The other thing you could do is you could pour it into the can and kind of swirl it around to get some more of the sauce in there. So that looks about, oh man, this wine, this is actually good wine. Okay, then I also put some sugar and white sugar. I've tried it with brown sugar. I definitely like it better with white sugar. And I just kind of eyeball it. Make sure you're not pouring out a bag of sugar or it's going to all fall out. Okay? And salt, pepper, Italian herbs. But... okay, yeah, maybe I'll put some of the rosemary and thyme in here. Salt. And then you can always do salt to taste. Like, I like salty things, so that's a problem. Now, some people will be like, why are you putting pepper in your sauce? Well, I just always do. Okay, here's thyme. And you just bring it off the stem. Okay, here's some rosemary. I mean, if you don't like big things of rosemary, don't do it. It's no big deal. Okay, I'll probably put two of rosemary and two thyme, two sprigs of thyme. Okay, that's two rosemary. Get one more thyme here. I don't know if you could see that. Yeah, can you see that? Yeah, looks really good. And then I'm going to go ahead and mix it. Oh, I turned off the stove when it was too hot. Okay, so that's that. So what we're gonna do is just let that simmer for about 10 minutes, because that's the time I have. I'm gonna bring it to a boil, then I'll simmer it. Right, it's come to a boil, so I'm gonna go ahead and lower it. That was about 10 minutes I had it, or 5 minutes I had it boiling. Then I'm just going to simmer it. Okay, it's been about 10 minutes, and I'm just gonna stir it up one more time. All right, and it's okay that it looks watery because it's in the baking dish, and then we're going to add the sausages, the ground beef that we had cooked earlier. Sometimes I just add the sauce to it, and then it cooks with the wine and the sugar. But either way. And then my husband is here to my left making eggs for his breakfast. So just mix it up. Okay, that's what it looks like. And I'm gonna let that simmer again for a little while more. Hi, honey.
Hi, lovelies.
No, they're friends.
Oh, friends.
When I had my other channel, Live Love Latte, I would say, hello, lovely, so he's just never forgotten that. Okay, the meat has simmered, finished simmering while I got this ready. So basically, I'm making the cheese sauce now. It's ricotta cheese. I get the whole milk, the 32 ounce, and you can never have enough cheese. So just plop it in there, break it down. And then I take 1 cup, this is 1 1/4 cup of Parmesan cheese. I put about half in there, because you're gonna wanna mix it thoroughly. And then I just take a big thing of mozzarella cheese. And if the recipe calls for 2 cups, I think, I put 4 cups, because I've done 2 cups and it's just not enough cheese. Okay, so that's 1 cup. Not enough cheese for us. Okay, this is 2. Okay, and then I'm gonna mix that just a little bit. And then you're supposed to put I think you put a little bit of salt. Then I'm gonna put a handful of parsley, you know, from the ones that we chopped up earlier. Okay, so I think that's it. And I think he just says 2 cups of mozzarella because you don't want the cheese to be kind of too chunky. The mozzarella makes it smooth. And when I say 4 cups, what I do is sometimes I put it in the cheese sauce and then I use another cup to, as I lay out the lasagna, I kind of sprinkle it around. Okay, can you see the, yeah, that consistency? This is really good. All right, where's that Parmesan? And then you have another bag of Parmesan to put it on the very top. And you can save some of that parsley to garnish on top also. So just, they're not even a cup. So I'll use the rest for the other cup and a fourth maybe to put as I layer. So just trying to make it thoroughly stirred, blended, whatever, folded. I don't know the terms. Just trying to make lasagna. So the reason I'm making lasagna for Thanksgiving, my brother asked for some type of pasta because he has 3 girls and they wanted pasta because I asked, what did they want? All right, that's that. Now it's time to put the lasagna together. This is a stone baking dish from Pampered Chef. I've had this forever. They last forever. So this is one of the things I highly recommend. One of the best purchases I've made for my kitchen. Sorry, some of the sauce went on my leg. Okay, so this is also the key, I think, with that Food Wishes recipe that changed my lasagna game, and that is to put meat sauce at the bottom. Okay, doesn't matter, and he says that doesn't matter if it's messy, doesn't matter if the lasagna noodles aren't lined up, or you have to split them in half and it's crooked, you don't have to cut them, you know, just tear them apart. Yeah, that's what he says. So but this is one of the, I think, made it makes a difference in the lasagna, because you're not, when you cut into it, the bottom layer isn't just a lasagna noodle, which is kind of like the dry, right? You have this nice meat sauce there that makes it juicy. Okay, so what I do is I just layer. You see that? Okay. Oh, by the way, let me show you my setup. So I have the pan here. Okay, the sauce there on the stove, the cheese, and then the lasagna noodles next to it. So just put everything in arm's reach and start putting it together. So versus, you know, walking to different counters in your kitchen. Okay. So this usually takes about 4 across and 1 vertical. So you see that? That's 4. Okay. And you don't need to tuck it in and all that jazz. So you see this is too much. So all you have to do is tear it. Okay. And it doesn't have to be perfect. No one's going to see that. And it doesn't make a difference in how it tastes. And that just helped me so much to know that, you know. See, look at, I'm tearing it some more and it's all, see, it's all not straight, which is okay. All right, just keep the scraps here because you might use it later. So now we got some meat, lasagna, meat. So this is something you can bring for a potluck. I even have a new bag that it takes hot and cold stuff, portable. portable bag or bag that you can make your food portable, because I have to serve it in this stoneware, okay? It cannot be in an aluminum pan. It cannot be in those tin foils. I'm trying to figure out how to make my lasagna and serve it in the chafing dish, but I may not have to because it just may not taste good. Okay, next is the cheese. Okay, so what you do is just take some cheese and you plop it down. Of course, make sure you have a good spoon for this. I just use the spoon that I use to mix it. So just little plops, because it's gonna all melt in, okay? I try to get the corners and the edges. Okay, that's about right, okay? Now we're gonna do more of the lasagna noodles. And these are the noodles that I kind of had on top of each other, but they're fine. They came off pretty well. Okay, so some are like, if they're kind of bending up, I just make it up, go upside down. Those are in half. I mean, you can even take these little scraps of lasagna and make like patches. Okay, now that's the first layer. So it's basically two layers and then like the top part. Okay, this last layer, you do the same thing. But now I'm going to add more of the cheese. And so another thing, if you notice, I tried to take out all the meat and put it in the second layer. And I put a lot of cheese on the first, on the that last layer, because I just had way too much cheese. I should have put more in the bottom layer. Okay, so then, yes, more sauce on top. Okay. And it's okay if it's watery like that. Oops, I forgot this. Oh well, sorry, I forgot that. And it's okay even if it's, the lasagna gets layered like that. And then we have this much cheese left. That's a lot of cheese, so I don't think I'm gonna add any mozzarella. I might just sprinkle the Parmesan. All right, so I have some of the Parmesan cheese here, and I'm just gonna sprinkle it on top. I'm sorry, the mozzarella cheese. Sorry, putting my hand into the bag. I did wash my hands though. Okay, one more. I love it, so much cheese. Love, love, love that. Okay, and then for the Parmesan, just a little bit. It doesn't melt as much, I think. It's not as gooey. Okay, that's that. And then I'm just going to take some of the parsley, like very little, because that will be cooked in. Oops. And then the rest. And then some more I'll be putting on top after it's cooked. All right, I've preheated the oven, 375. It's been preheating for about 5 minutes. And then I'm going to let it cook for 30. Then I'll turn it off and then it'll be reheated again later. Okay, friends, thanks for sticking with me this long. I started at 7:15, it's now 12:15. It's been 5 hours of standing, puttering around my kitchen, cooking, prepping, cutting, talking to you guys. You know, it's been a nice Thanksgiving so far. So I'm gonna make the turkey wing. Okay, and wash the turkey. Fits perfectly in there, in this dish that's gonna go in my toaster oven. So it doesn't have to be in the regular oven. One day I'll have my dream kitchen, but for now this is what I have. So this butter, luckily, has been sitting out. And I'm gonna try to get under the skin. Okay, it's kind of hard to do, but I'll do what I can. Oh, there's some there. Okay, probably if I make an incision here, but I don't really wanna do that. Let me know if you make turkey, get the full turkey. Okay, so that's that. And then I'm just gonna push this on to the top. Not the best, but I'm losing, what's that called? I'm getting tired. Okay, that's good. Let me go wash my hands. All right, so I have poultry seasoning. This is a great seasoning. I just use it all the time. All right, this is the one that's open. Okay. So Montreal chicken, and I'm just gonna put it on generously. And I think with the herbs, those fresh herbs, since I don't really have a spot to put them under, I might just use this. Okay, again, this is just for me. I don't know who wants any of it, but I'm good. Okay, there, simple. So this is the one that I would have liked to put in, but it's too much work for now. Then I'm gonna put this in the toaster oven at, what do you say, 325, 350, 375 for about 30 minutes. I'm just gonna check it. I don't know, I have no idea. All right, it's in my toaster oven. It's heating up, 350, convection roast for 20 minutes. Okay, I just decided I'm gonna cut up some of the sage and use some of the thyme and rosemary for the stuffing. Okay. Now for my stuffing, it's a recipe I've used with challah bread forever. And I don't put any nuts, because for those who are allergic. Okay, I got that. Then I have some of the rosemary. This I might chop up a little bit. Smells good. Okay, some of the thyme. Right, then I'm gonna chop up onions and celery. For the stuffing, some oil, and then put the onions, the celery, herbs, salt, pepper. Okay, I also added butter, lots of butter. Okay, good enough. And then I'm gonna start adding the bread, because I want to toast it a little bit. Mix it together, then we'll add the vegetable stock, because some of that butter and the water from the celery is gonna soften it already. See? Okay, you can see here, I took the lasagna out, that's ready. And I did forget to mention that, yes, you can cover it, or you cannot cover it. I've done both ways. Honestly, it doesn't make a difference, in my opinion. Okay, now I'm adding some dried cranberries to the stuffing. I've turned off the heat. Then you can kind of see if it's too dry for you, how much vegetable stock to put. So I'll just put a little bit of vegetable broth. Add more cranberries. Oh, that's pretty. That looks good. And then I'm gonna put it in this, the matching pan for the mashed potatoes. And I'll probably toast this in the oven. Right, can you see that? Yeah, I mean, I guess I just don't want it too wet. Could add a little more. Then some parsley. My husband surprised me. I thought he was setting up in the kitchen table, but he has set up here in the dining room. Yeah, he did all this and added the bottles of wine and the wine glasses. So even if they're going to drink, let's say, the sparkling water soda, we'll just use the wine glasses. Here's some pumpkins and candles. Have the knife there for the prime rib. It's very, very nice. My brother's bringing pumpkin pie and cheesecake, so that's ready to go. We're also serving shrimp cocktails, so these are jumbo prawns I get from the local butcher. They also do seafood there, and make our own cocktail sauce. And I learned that from someone. It's basically ketchup, horseradish, Worcestershire sauce, lemon, and Tabasco there. And so I put a second one here. Then I'm gonna serve the food here by the stove. And so here are the mashed potatoes. They all have to be heated up first. And this is the stuffing. And I use little plates with spoons. This will be for the broccolini, cranberry sauce. The prime rib will be here. Here's the carving stuff. Tongs for the broccolini, spoon for the cranberry sauce. Here is the lasagna. That's the lasagna spatula. Here's a spatula where we're going to put the leche flan. Click the next video for more organizing, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.